and greatly to be praised.
And greatly to be praised.
Greatness
of the Lord is inconceivable.
The love that he shows,
the love that he shows is unconditional.
Power of the Lord,
power of the Lord
is unbeatable.
Great is the God.
Come on, you can sing this with us. God is great.
God is great.
Come on. And great is to be
praised. And great is to be praised. To be praised.
Come on, let's take it up. God is great.
God is great.
Oh, yes, he is. Did he wake you up this morning?
And greatly to be praised.
That's the reason that God is great. Hallelujah.
God is great.
Oh, 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 oh. And greatly to be praised.
And greatly to be praised. To be praised.
God is great.
God is great.
Yes, he is. Yes. Oh, bless your name, God, and greatly.
And greatly to be praised.
Let's sing it up. God is great.
God is great.
Oh, and greatly to
be praised. And greatly to be praised.
For another opportunity to bless your name. We thank you for bringing us here safely. We thank you for everybody in this building, God. Lord, let those that are listening and online and those that are in the sanctuary be blessed by you like never before, oh God. For some of them, they need to be healed. Some of them need to be set free. God, we ask that you just meet them right where they are. Father, we ask that you bless this worship experience like never before. Let us feel your presence even now and even beyond this service. In the name of Jesus, we praise you and we thank you. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
What is the highest name that we know? Jesus is the highest name that we know. Amen.
All right.
So I don't care what you're facing. If you call on his name, things have to change.
Yeah.
It's not that they might change or kind of little like change. They have to change when the name of Jesus is called. So this song just says, we love to call your name. Hallelujah.
We love to call your name. It's something we cannot explain. That happens something we cannot explain that happens when we proclaim your great name.
Yeah. Father, we thank you, we honor you, we adore you. There's no one like you. God, thank you for a beautiful day. Thank you for allowing us to get here safely. Thank you for your mercy covering us from day to day, your grace being more than sufficient, your love being unconditional, and your power being everlasting. God, saturate us with your presence even now as we listen to your word. May we do some things different. May we speak some things in a different way. May we become who you are calling us to be, shaped in your image and likeness of yourself. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Let us all say together, amen.
Amen.
Your mind remain standing. Pull your Bibles, your phones, or however you read God's word. We're going back to Matthew chapter 11 today. Amen. Matthew chapter 11. Amen. Matthew chapter 11, starting at the 25th verse. And as you're going there, turning there, getting there. Last week we were dealing with the issue, the topic of doubt, and we're going to close out this chapter 11 of Matthew dealing with rest. Because here's what I know, the majority of you don't rest with.
Amen.
And rest is more than just sleep. Let me just put that out there. It's your mind coming to a place where you understand and trust God, even though you don't know what God is up to. Mm-hmm. It's getting beyond saying it's in my hands versus knowing that all things are in his hands.
All right.
It's getting to a place where you're okay without knowing everything. Now, how many of you know that's a hard place to be?
Amen.
Because how many of you want to know everything?
All right.
Everything. Those of you who got kids, you got 25 questions you can rattle off in less than 60 seconds because you're trying to know everything. And they trying to hold on to it. And then you get frustrated as a parent. But imagine how frustrated God gets with us.
All right.
Because here's the deal. In his case, he knows everything. Mm. And you trying to withhold something he already knows. So he looks at us and goes, are you serious right now? You think I don't know you want to put that person in a chokehold? You think I don't know that you got some choice words for them? Be honest with me. So we going to deal with rest. It comes, by the way, if you'll follow with me, it comes on the heels of John's, what I call, prison meltdown, where he's questioning, Jesus, if you are who you say you are, come show up, or should I be looking for somebody else? And while we've not maybe said those words, there have been times where we've thought those words. Jesus, if you are who you say you are, show up, or should I be looking for somebody else? So Jesus explains, he breaks down, we dealt with that last week. Then he gets into dealing with obedience, because can I tell you, obedience supersedes rest.
Amen.
When we are obedient, we can rest. Mm-hmm. Because we don't rest well when we know we haven't done something right. Mm-hmm. Okay. It's early, it's nice outside, please cooperate with me. But how many of you know what it's like to feel like, or wonder, or think to yourself, man, I didn't handle that the best way. I gotta deal with that, because I'm tossing and I'm turning. But can I tell you something else that caused us to toss and turn? Previous hurts, trials, tribulations, misunderstandings. All those things cause us a place of unrest. So we're going to read verses 25 through 30. I want us to read them out loud, whatever version you have. If you don't have a version, you can read it on the screen. But on the count of three, we're going to do this together online. Those of you who are watching from your home or out of town, if you would just read along right wherever you are, whether it's in the car or in your living room. Here's what it says on the count of three. One, two, three, let's go. At that time, Jesus said, I praise you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because you have hidden these things from the wise and intelligent and have revealed them to infants.
Keep reading. Even so, Father, for it seemed good in thy sight. All things are delivered unto me of my Father, and no man knoweth the Son but the Father. Neither knoweth any man the Father, save the Son. And he whosoever the Son will reveal. Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest unto your soul. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light.
Y'all sound so good saying it out loud. We're going to talk for a few moments this morning about the Savior's rest. The Savior's rest. You may have a seat. Please have a seat. You can kind of stand. Have a seat. Amen. Today will be interactive because I want to challenge all of us, myself included, to walk away with some practical items about how to trust and allow us to experience God's rest. It was C.S. Lewis who said, God whispers to us in our pleasures, speaks to us in our consciousness, but shouts through our pains. He says it is his megaphone to rouse the world. There's something about trouble and trial, issues and circumstances that causes us to tune in a little bit more to God than we normally would. And in this end of this chapter, Jesus is speaking and breaking down and talking about the fact that there is some things that we just are going to have to trust and put in his hands. He doesn't tell us that when we put it in his hands that life is going to get easy, but rather he tells us life can be then endured without the weight of things we were never meant to carry. Have you ever been in a gym or had a gym class where you watch somebody bench weight, and as they're climbing in weight, all of a sudden when they get to that one set and they can't push it any longer and they need somebody on the side, a spotter, if you will, right, to help them get the weight up. Jesus is trying to reach some of us this morning to remind us that not only is he the spotter, but he was the one intended to carry the weight that we're carrying in the first place.
Yeah.
Can I suggest why some of us, our minds have to stop? It's because our minds are on something God never intended it to be on. Can I suggest this morning that some of us never sleep because we're carrying things when Jesus said, I'm the one who never sleeps nor slumbers. Can I put in our hearing this morning that some of our headache and heartache is not what happened to us, is what we held on to when God tried to force our hand open to say, let it go. Can I talk to somebody this morning and get us at a place where we can understand that we are not the end all to all things. I know you wear a cape. I know you could jump off a building in a single bound, but let me tell you, there are just some things in life God never intended for us to handle. Yet, he gives us the ability to handle things because he does not take us out of the world. He said we're in the world, but we're not of the world. So we don't get a pass to escape, even though sometimes we want to escape. How many of you know you've been on a vacation and just never wanted it to end? It wasn't so much the place, it was what was going on in the place that you left and how life was happening. And you said to yourself, if I could just stay here for a little while longer, it would be all right. We, 2 years ago, went to Punta Cana right before Christmas. And when we got there, I said, this is what heaven has to be. Because every day was about 85 degrees. I wore a short and t-shirts for a week in the month of December, my birth month. And let me tell you, when they started talking about the end and coming to an end, I was saying, oh no, Lord, you got to be calling me to the beach. They can shoot me on the screen. I will be live on the scene. There are souls here in this warm water and hot sand that need Jesus. And I believe you are calling me to be the one to tell them about Christ is Lord. But God didn't see it that way. And in fact, the reality of it was when we got back here and got off the plane,
plane, we had to buy coats in the airport because St. Louis was at 28 degrees and we were in 85. It was a cold reality to the fact that you cannot escape life, but there seems then, if we can't escape it, there must be a way to get through it and do it with joy. And that's what God is speaking to us through the writer Matthew here in this text. Matthew writes to prove to a group and an audience that Jesus is the Messiah. He is the one you've been waiting on. He is the Savior of the world, even though he's not packaged the way that you think he should be. And so he gets to this after talking to John and after talking about being obedient, because let's be real, none of us really like that word obedient. That's up there with that word submission. They're like that Christian language I call that you're not supposed to speak. Heaven forbid you say submission and obedience in the same sentence. Because depending on where you are, you just might get stoned. But the reality of it is rest is found in submission and obedience. So he's laying that out. And then we get to this verse in chapter 11, verse 25. We see this invocation coming from God. The text says, at this time, Jesus said, I praise you, Father. That praise there means I honor and adore you ongoing, not just one time for you doing something for me that I like, but rather I praise you, Lord, because you are Lord. It is continuous. Here's the prayer. He says, I pray, watch this, that you have hidden some things from certain people, those who think they are wise and understanding. In other words, he says, Jesus does, God, I'm grateful that you don't show everything to everybody, because everybody can't not only handle, but some can't even hear, because they're too caught up in themselves to understand that you are Master and Lord. Right. Now, some of us are shaking our head because we know people like that, but are we willing to admit that we all have moments like that?
Amen.
Where we look at it and say, I know best. We don't say the words, but our actions do the talking. So when God is saying go this way, no, I think this way is better. It will get me there faster, less headache and heartache, only to go that way and find out it wouldn't. I was traveling out of town once, and I'm driving, trying to get to a particular location at a particular time, and I like to be on time, especially when it's just me, because then I don't have to worry about the other three people that I love. I didn't catch that. And so I'm driving, and there's a detour. I see it, and they're directing traffic another way. And so I didn't follow the detour signs. Can I tell you, I spent the next hour going down every street, only to find there was a dead-end street at the end of the street. I had to turn back around, loop back around. Oh, I'm going to go this way, and I'm going to get there before everybody else do, only to find myself an hour later in the same detour line that I was in from the beginning, to find out that if I would have just took the detour, I'd have been at my destination in less than 3 minutes. Cost me an hour, and I walk in late. And I'm kind of hard to hide. So when I walk in, all eyes shift to the big, dark black man walking in late. All because I wasn't willing to follow and be obedient. He says here, I'm grateful, God, that you conceal and hide some things. There are some people, even in church, watch this. He's not just speaking to those outside of the body of Christ. He's speaking to those of us who are in the body as well to say, there are some things from us he's hidden because we're not at a place where we're willing to submit and follow and hear what God has to say. He says, I thank you, Lord, that you've hidden some things from them, the haughty, the high, the lifted up. But then he says, I'm also glad that you reveal yourself to people who are infants. Woo. Now, how many of us that messes with us if somebody right now walked in and called you a child? If somebody approached you right now and said, you acting like a child, most of us would lose what little Jesus we got. How dare you speak to me in that manner? Do you know who I am? Must I show you who I am? And begin to maneuver and craft sentences together so fast and so smooth with language that I cannot even remind myself to say, let alone even think about uttering in the sanctuary to put them in their place. But the reality of it is the way with God is to be childlike faith. Because a child, watch this, just trust that you gonna take care of it. The child don't even know if you capable or not. The child is just there and totally dependent, believing that you gonna do everything you said you were going to do. And so Jesus is saying to us here, if you want to, watch this, receive what I got, which is rest, and we get ready to get into that, it's you gotta have childlike faith. So here's where the party gets interactive. I'm going to ask you to talk back to me. What do you think stops us often from having childlike faith? 60 seconds. Throw some words out at me. What keeps us from trusting like a child?
Fear.
What else? Pride. Ooh, pride is a... Yeah. Pride is a dangerous thing. You can't tell me. I know. Okay. You ever met somebody so prideful and they walk off, you kind of just want to trip them and watch them fall? Oh, that's me. I'm sorry. I pray about that after y'all leave church. What else you got? Fear, pride, what else?
Integrity.
Can't see it. If I can't see it, that mean it ain't real, right? Uh-huh. I'm in the show me state. You got to show me before I believe you. And Lord forbid you don't show me. And you come back and ask or say it again. Could you imagine in the Old Testament being the prophet who was talking about rain and wasn't no rain coming? First day, he probably went over real good and everybody had their umbrellas. After a little while, it was probably like, is this dude for real? Man, I ain't bringing no umbrella. Think about how many times a forecaster said it's gonna rain and you said to yourself, they got it wrong. The sun is out. I ain't putting that umbrella in the car. It's in the other car. I ain't going back home to get it. Then all of a sudden, out of nowhere, for 5 minutes, it rains like nobody's business. Then you mad at the forecaster like he did something wrong. When he told you it was going to rain, he just couldn't tell you what time. So what else you got? What else? What else keeps us from childlike faith? Patience. I'm supposed to be able to push a button and God deliver. I got a microwave. I push it, my food done in 60 seconds. Why can't I push God's button? We may not say it, but there are times where we feel it. Like, God, can I program this like I program my DVR so that when this is over, that it can line up the way I want it to. But in order to have childlike faith, here's childlike faith characteristics. It's not knowing, not being in control, not being able to spell out what you really need, not being able to step up and take things into your own hands. It's to be completely dependent, completely submissive, completely believing that whatever's gonna happen is for your good. Now, how many of us know right now you need some help growing up into some childlike faith? And so Jesus is making a prayer here. He says, here's the prayer. I'm praying that they have childlike faith. Why? Because verse 26 says, yes, Father, for this way was well-pleasing in your sight. It pleased God to hide and to help. It pleased him to conceal and reveal. It pleased him to not tell everything to some and tell everything to somebody. It pleased him. Why? Because when we are in his will, that brings glory to his name. Don't you know he takes great, watch this, love and joy in hearing us being able to say, I don't know, but I believe God.
Amen.
But yet, when life is hard and it don't make sense and it's not going the way we want it to and things ain't turning out according to our plans and task lists, and in 5 years we were supposed to be here only to find ourselves in 3 years over here, and it don't look like in 2 more years we're going to meet the goal, something about us don't want to say, I don't know. Right. How many of you know you'll find an answer first before you'll say, I don't know? Especially if it's one of your kids, you dare not want to be in front of them and say, I don't know. My father tried to tell me early on when my son was first born, he said, listen, the boy gonna give you moments where he gonna do stuff like you, and you ain't gonna understand it, because you don't understand why you did it, and you did it like me, and I don't understand why I did it. And you're gonna have to just say, I don't know. Of course, now I looked at him, I smiled and all of that. Okay. And then I got in the midst of it, he was right. And the first time I had to tell that boy at about 2 or 3, I don't know, son. And he looked at me like,
but you're supposed to. And I said, son, I really don't know. I don't understand. And he dropped his head. I felt like a failure. But then I remembered that God said, I'm not supposed to know everything. The world is conditioned to try and push us to be something sometimes that we're not. He didn't call us to be everybody's savior, everybody's answer, everybody's supply. That's his job. Our job is to follow him and be who he called us to be. So I don't have to line up and you don't have to line up to somebody else's expectation, because that's not what pleases him. What pleases him when we have childlike faith and sometimes have to say with people as they're suffering, I don't know why you're suffering, but I believe God.
Amen.
I don't know when you're going to come out of it, but I believe God. I don't know what it's going to do to you on the other side, but I believe God. I ain't got no answers for you. I ain't got no cute cliches. I don't even know the words to pray for you, but I believe God, because that's what causes him to rejoice. The text says, yes, Father, this way was pleasing in your sight, in his sight. Which means everything that he's doing in his children, if they're his, is about giving him pleasure, not always about us receiving. Can I tell you, that's what messes us up. When I get involved with counseling and married couple, I tell them out the gate, now, you need to understand, marriage ain't about you being happy. And you should see some of them how their eyes open up. Because they're looking at it like this is going to be a part-time thing, and when I get tired of it, we can break up. I tell them, no, this is about being holy and bringing reverence to God. Ooh, wait a minute. I thought this was my license that so I could, Now, some of y'all are going to sit here trying to play me like you don't know what I'm trying to say. Go ahead, throw your one finger up and walk. I thought that this was going to be me getting right with God. But the reality of it is, no, this is about bringing him honor and glory. And God is saying through Jesus here in the text, listen, this is what's pleasing to me. This is what causes me to rejoice. Here is my roadmap, childlike faith. Faith that doesn't explain everything. Now, I admit, I'm the first one to struggle, because I like to appear at least some areas, sometimes smart. I like to be able to say, no, I don't know everything, but I know a little bit about a little bit. But yet there are moments that God hands us in life where we're not supposed to know. We're just supposed to be childlike and trust him. Because have you noticed, when your kids walk around and they ain't got to pay no bills and they ain't got to worry about buying no food, and when they ain't got to worry about even getting from point A to point B because they can't drive, do it look like they really concerned or got a worry or wait on them? And God is saying, I give you a picture every day when you wake up and you go in their room and you see them asleep while you up worrying about how the roof going to stay together and how the car going to get fixed and how the tuition going to get paid. God is saying, I want you to do the same thing. I want you to go to sleep tonight and I want you to rest in me, because I've already accounted for all your hang-ups, mishaps, misunderstandings, sin, and I nailed it to a cross to save you so that my blood would cover you. Childlike faith is the roadmap. That's the roadmap. But can we be honest? Sometimes the holdup is a word I like to call ego. Ego says, I know about God. I know God's ways and precepts. And therefore, whatever it is I want to do, as long as I'm doing it by the Bible, it should happen. Wrong. That would make you Jesus too.
All right.
I've known plenty of people who know the Bible and still find themselves in a jam and in a place in life where the Bible seemingly has left the building. No, it hasn't left the building. That's just a place for childlike faith where God is saying, you've got to put this in my hands and trust me. Watch this. Even when you look foolish to those you love.
Amen.
Even when your friends don't think you make sense.
Because this is what I'm asking you for. That's the roadmap. So that's the invocation. But check this out. He gives us, watch this, the implication. He says in verse 27, all things have been handed over to me. Not some things, all things have been handed over to me. Can I tell you the good news of that for a believer? That means wherever we are and whatever we face and whatever trouble we in, whether we got there on our own or life just happened, Jesus says it was all handed over to me. Which means we don't have to keep it in our hands. I'm trying to help somebody today to unloosen your hands. Because what's keeping you is your own hands trying to hold something together that God never called you to hold together. He says, I'm the mender of broken hearts. Psalms 147:3, a verse that has always messed me up. He says in the verse, I will mend your broken heart. Not I will keep it from being broken. Not that I won't let you go through some things, but I will mend it, which means it's going to get broken so that I can put it back together. Because when I put it back together, it'll be better than what it was when you got it.
Amen.
So here it is. He says all things. In other words, the implication is authority belongs to Jesus. Woo, that's another nasty Christian word. Authority. How many adults are here saying, I can't wait till I get grown? Don't you realize how foolish that statement is now? One day life hit me like a ton of bricks. I drove to Berkeley while my dad was still living, pulled up in the driveway and got out and said, I don't want to be grown no more. I'm going back in the back where my room is. You got my bed back there? I'm checking out. Forever. I looked at him and told him that was the dumbest thing I ever uttered out of my mouth. Why didn't you tell me? I did try to tell you. You just didn't listen. Because humanly, we all have a problem with authority. Because there's a piece of us due to the fall of what happened in the garden that says, I want to take life in my own hands. That's why self-help books sell so well. 7 steps to a turnaround. 3 steps to becoming rich. 5 steps to losing 20 pounds in 5 minutes. All of that stuff. Because the premise that what makes it sell, if you're watching this online, don't buy it, send it back to Amazon. Here's why. The premise of what makes it sell is the fact that it seems to suggest that you got the authority to do everything and anything you want. But tell that to cancer when it happened. Tell that to when high blood pressure come out of nowhere and you eat right. Tell that to the person who smashed your car while you was driving in the lane you were supposed to and they was doing whatever they want. There's things in life that men and women just don't have authority over. But there is somebody who has authority over all things. And His name is Jesus. Jesus says, I handle all things. Jesus tells us, plain and simple, you ain't got no business that's your business that I ain't in. Don't that mess with you? Because the first thing I couldn't wait to say to my daddy was, this my business. You can't tell me what to do. And what I learned was he couldn't wait to say, okay, son, go for it. For me to be back that night. Can I tell you we do that to God all the time because we don't understand that, watch this, there's a blessing and a gift and grace in allowing him to be in charge. Because that means we, in a sense, give up certain things that we don't have to be responsible for and can live free. He says, all things have been handed to me by my Father. He says, God the Father put it all in my hands. He entrusted it to me. Watch this. So that the rest of the verse, so no one knows the Son except the Father, nor does anyone know the Father except the Son, and anyone to whom the Son reveals. It's the intimacy. It's speaking of a part of the Trinity between the Father and the Son, how they interact together. Intimacy, knowing each other well. This isn't just a mental recognition. This is intimate. He says, we intimately know each other. And I'm willing to let you into this intimate relationship if I so will to reveal myself to you. Could it be you are where you are and I am where I am and we're facing what we're facing, whatever that looks like, good, bad, or ugly, so that Jesus can reveal the Father to us? Yeah, So here's my next question, where we're going to get interactive. What often would you say are some things that stand in our way from hearing what God is trying to say? Stubbornness. How many of you know no matter what, you're going to do it your way? No matter what.
Amen.
It could be a process over here with three easy steps. You going with your 10. Because that's what you know. And because that's what I know and I trust me. Hashtag, I trust me. This is what I'm going to do. That's a good one. What else? What else? Stubbornness. Come on. Come with it.
Wrong priorities.
Wrong priorities. But you don't understand how I feel about them. I remember my dad and sister having that conversation a thousand times. Dad, you don't understand. Okay. 2 days later, they fired. Wrong priorities. Or the thing we save up for because we believe we can't do without it. Only to spend a lot of money and wish you had never bought it. Yeah. I heard people all the time, pray that I'm able to get this house or this car. No, I ain't going to pray for that because that's easy to get. I'm going to pray that you can make the note.
Come on, amen.
Come on now.
Because they're signing you up for a loan. That ain't hard. I'm going to pray that you can maintain the note. Because I want to see your heart broke when they hook up their truck and come get it back.
Say that.
You're not hearing me. That's a good one. Priorities. What else keep us from hearing God? Stubbornness, priorities. What else? Come on, be honest. What else?
Stubbornness.
Others, appearances. Ooh. I got to be like them. When I was in the fifth grade, I played basketball, and the whole team got one kind of shoe. That was out of my daddy's price range. He said, I ain't buying it. I came on, but dad, I showed him the pictures. I did my research. I did my research. Like, look, this is what it do for your feet and all that. That's out of my price range. That's the only number. That's the only part of the details of my sales pitch. I was tight. I rehearsed it on the bus. I got off the bus. I was good to go, so I thought. I walked in. He kept saying no. So I started trying to figure out ways where I could maybe cut some grass, get enough, but I couldn't get enough in time for when the first game came. So long story short, I had to go with the shoe that was in his price range. Everybody else's shoes was black. Mine was white. Because that was the shoe that was in his price range. I never forget, I walked on the basketball court with my head down. There was no joy there whatsoever. And when it was over, I sat in the car, didn't say anything. He said, "We had a good game." I didn't talk.
We had a good game.
I ain't say nothing. And then finally, he said, "Boy, you better say something." I said, "Dad, you didn't see me out there. My shoes look different than everybody else." He said, "Did that affect how many points you scored?"
Hello.
No. "Did that do anything to help you run any faster?"
No.
So then what's the problem? You trying to be like everybody else. There's a cost to be like everybody else. Because appearances will drive you to a place outside of God's boundaries just so you can slide in and feel where.
Yes.
It was a tough lesson. It was a painful lesson in the fifth grade. But let me tell you, now when mines come home, that ain't in my price range. You gonna learn the appearance lesson too. Because here's the reality. Here's the reality. Jesus is saying that I've got some things for you that may look unorthodox to those around you or to yourself. But if you trust me enough, here's the implication. I'll continue to pour out and reveal myself. Because the most important thing is Jesus.
Yes. Amen. Yes.
So he's teaching them that. So he's giving us an implication. He's giving us the implications. But here's the part I love. He's giving us an invitation. He says, come to me. And when I first read that, I thought that come to me, come, that word I thought was an imperative or a command. It is not. So in essence, he's really extending himself, saying, come to me. I know you've got trouble. I know you've got issues. I know you've probably given up on me and people who identify with me, but come to me. Here's what he says in verse 28. All who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. All who are weary, not some of us, all. Can I tell you where we struggle in the church today? It's because we don't want all to come. We only want some to come. And the some I want to come need to line up and identify with what's important and concerning to me. But Jesus said, I've opened up the gates of the church when I died on the cross for all to come. Amen. Black, white, rich, poor, whatever your issue is or concern. That's why Luke says he called it a hospital, called himself the great physician, because he says, you ain't got an issue that I can't handle and that I can't heal. So he says, all who are weary. Weary means tired from audacious work, meaning you've been working yourself into the ground, because we live in a busy age. Right now, let me ask you, how many of you right now today got at least two things to do after church?
At least.
Because there's no white space. How many of you feel bad if you're not doing something? Be honest. If you ain't on the move, you feel like something's off. When's the last time you scheduled on your calendar to be off? And I ain't talking about from work. I'm talking about just from everything that is required of you after work hours. Jesus says, for those who just keep working and define themselves by their busyness, come to me. And then he says, heavy laden. Heavy laden means you experiencing trial, issue, or whatever, not because of something you did, but because of maybe something somebody else did, but yet the implications are now. It happened in the past, but you're dealing with it in the present. You've got generational stuff you're trying to fight through. You didn't make the decision they did, but you're trying to live through it. He says, take all of that and your hard work and come to me. I will give you rest. Notice he didn't say come to a man, don't come to a woman, don't come to the bank. All the stuff that we typically tie up and say, if I get more money, it'll fix it. If I get with the right person, it'll be all right. If I enter the right network, it'll come together. He said, nope, none of that's going to work. Why? Because man on his greatest day still is flawed and on some point going to let you down. But he says, come to me and you'll find rest. 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 There is a place of rest. Hebrews says there's a final rest for those of us who are believers, and it is spending eternity with the Lord. And he says there's a rest even now. Bring your sins. Repent. He says, come to me, and I will forgive you and give you grace and give you rest. Come to me with that which you're wrestling with, which that you can't figure out, which you think you can't do without, and you'll find rest in me. Shake that thing loose that you keep holding on to that you don't need to hold on to because you think you can't do without it. Let it go and come to me. And he says, I will give you rest.
Yeah.
And I suggest many of us, self-included, don't rest because we ain't willing to give up what he's asking us to. You don't understand what that's going to cost me. You're right, I don't, but he does.
Mm-hmm.
And last I checked, the Bible says he owns the earth and all therein.
Amen.
Yes.
There ain't a check that you need that he can't cover.
Amen.
Amen.
It ain't a pill that you can take that he can't supersede in.
Yes, yes. Right. Yeah.
There ain't a situation that he can't work through. But we've got to be willing to have childlike faith and believe that when we give him our weariness and our heavy ladens, that he will give us rest. Which means the outcomes might not go the way we want them to.
Right.
We think he's trying to change people. No, he's trying to change us.
Amen.
So he says, come to me. Bring it to me. Bring your headaches. Bring your frustration. Bring your sins. Repent of them. Come to me. Bring what has broken you. I will restore you. I've got a plan for your life. Come to me. You don't have to pace the floor. You don't have to wallow around. You don't have to try new remedies. Come to me. Jesus says, bring it to me. He says the criteria is, if you, watch this, you're weary or heavy laden. How many of you fall in one of them buckets or both?
Amen.
Amen.
That's the criteria. Don't have to fill out an application. Don't have to run a credit check. He just says, if you're weary and you're tired and if you're carrying what you shouldn't, bring it to me. But can I tell you what culture has done to us? It makes us feel like if I gotta come to him with it, that means that something's wrong with me and I can't handle it. Can I just blow your mind up for a little bit? He intended it to be something you couldn't handle.
Right.
Because if we could handle anything, well, why would we need him?
Right.
If we could fix everything on our own, why would we need him? If you're watching this online, let me help you for a moment. The comforts of your home won't fix it. Only Jesus can. It says, come to me.
Yes.
I will give this to you. That's the criteria he gives us. Now, here comes the command. Take my yoke upon you. He says, take my yoke, my yoke. Take my yoke upon you. Learn from me. How many of you know everything already? How many of you're the smartest person you know? You might not say it, but how many of you deep down? You sitting there watching, listening to somebody else say it, they just ask me. They wouldn't even have to go through all that. He says, take my yoke. Take, watch this, is a command. Learn is a command. It's another way of saying, allow me to disciple you. Yoke is an instrument, a wooden instrument that oxen put on. You can have one or two pulling. He says, take off what you've been carrying. Put on my yoke, which means you're not getting out of working, but work gets easier. Because when you got somebody pulling alongside of you who can handle the weight, you don't have to work as hard. Jesus says, put my yoke on and life won't be as hard as it is right now. That doesn't mean you won't face some hard times, but your hard times will look different because now you understand that I am the one in control and I'm able to pull my weight because most of us are furious with working with other people or doing stuff in pairs or in teams is wondering if the other folk gonna pull their weight and will you have to do their job. The one thing about Jesus is you never have to worry about if he gonna do his part because Jesus is always capable and willing and able to do his part. So all we have to do is put on the yoke and he'll carry us the rest of the way.
Amen.
Yeah. So there it is. He says, take and learn of me. That word learn is formal and informal. It's not just classroom textbook. It's life. It's going through things and understanding on the other side how he's trying to shape and make us better. He don't allow pain to just come. He don't waste pain. Pain has purpose. He don't waste trouble. Trouble are teaching moments. I shared with you before, met a pastor down in Florida. He gave his testimony. He said, I learned more about God through cancer than I did before I had it. He said, I grew closer to God going through cancer and got to the end of it and discovered whether I live or I die, I was at peace because I learned more about him in the middle of it. And then he had the audacity and the boldness to say, I thank God I got it so I could get closer to him.
Amen.
I shrunk down in my seat and began to cry because I know I wouldn't ask or be able to say anything like that. But what he was looking at was the fact that God had gave him a rest that he didn't have before he had it. But his affliction brought him closer to the one who could handle the afflicted, and then it brought him answers that he couldn't receive before that he could hear now, and it brought him a trust to say, I might not know all the answers of how this gonna turn out, but I'm gonna sleep tonight because I hold myself in the hands of the one who knows all.
Amen.
Can I tell you, until we drop us out of the way, you will never rest. At best, you're gonna sleep a few hours, but you'll never rest. He says, come, learn. That's the command. Here's his character. He said, for I am gentle and humble in heart. Jesus says, listen, my character is good. The essence of me is I'm gentle and I'm humble and I love you. For you being you, not your representative. Because all of us got a representative and a real. That's what makes dating so hard and I don't miss it. Trying to get through somebody's representative.
Yes.
Yes.
waiting to go to the family reunion so you can see the real them. Because they going to be in representative mode, but they kinfolk going to be real.
Yeah.
I told my son, you want to know how your future wife is going to be? Just spend time with her mama.
Ooh, Lord, not the mama.
Because you're going to get perfect insight.
Yes.
You're going to get perfect insight to what she's being exposed to. If her parents are married, just spend time with her parents.
And preach.
Yes.
Because then you're going to get to see it all. That don't mean that it's bad, but you better go into it knowing. Mm-hmm. But Jesus says, I love you enough and I know all. Jesus says, there's nothing you can cover up for me because I know it all. It's already exposed in heaven and I love you. So come to me. He says, that's my character. But here's the clarity. He said, when you take my yoke on you, it's easy and it's light. Mm-hmm. It's easy and it's light. When's the last time life been easy for you? Mm-hmm. How many of you, life always seems like a strain?
Mm-hmm.
Could it be because we got on the wrong yoke? Because Jesus says, my yoke is easy and light. Now, that doesn't mean that heavy situations don't happen in life. It just means when we've got the right yoke on, he carries us. I close with this. Me and Kendall had this routine every morning. It's during the school week. Wife, son, we first. It's me and her. Okay, Kendall, it's time to get up. When it's a morning where she don't want to get up, we got to play this game. She's going to put the cover over here. I move it. She's going to roll on the other side. I turn the lights on. She put her hands behind her head. And pretend like she don't know what's going on. I look at her. I say, Kendall, we do this 5 days a week. You know what time it is. We get up. We start going through the motions of getting dressed. I sit her on the side of the bed. It's time to put your shoes on. We put our shoes on. Now she's kind of a little bit up. Then she does one big stretch like this and then just plunges herself forward towards me. This happens like every day, Monday through Friday. I said, Kendall, that was cute when you were like a year old. You are almost 13 now.
Uh-huh.
And almost my height.
Mm-hmm.
That ain't cute no more. You just plunging all your weight and all your everything on me. She just simply would look back and smile and laugh, as if to say, tough. Yeah. Here's the lesson I've learned in her doing that over time. The fact is, no matter how much she's grown and no matter how much weight she's added, she still believes that no matter what, when I do this, that you're going to be there to catch me, guide me, and take me where I need to be.
Yeah.
And can I tell you what's holding some of us up in here, this sanctuary this morning, is you really need to throw your hands behind your head and plunge forward and trust that when you lunge into Jesus' arms, that he's got enough weight and enough ability to carry.
Amen.
Preach.
Amen.
Yes, sir.
Can I tell you, when she does that, she don't have a care in the world. It never dawns on her the fact that I could possibly drop her. In her mind, I know you got me. So I'm going to do this every day because I know you ain't going to fail me. Can I tell you, for some of us, Jesus is just waiting for us to plunge into his arms and throw our hands up to show that he can catch us, because he's saying, I've never dropped you. I've never left you. I was with you when you wasn't with me. I loved you when you didn't love me. And I care for you when you walk away. I walk with you and bring you back. Now, somebody in here needs to grasp that idea and that concept so that tonight when you go to sleep, you can actually rest.
Amen.
Amen.
If you've got somebody next to you, take their hand. Here's my prayer, is that you actually allow yourself to experience his rest. Online, my prayer to you as you sit, wherever you sit,
that you allow yourself, even in the comforts of your home or wherever you are, to rest. Mm-hmm. Because here's what I know. Most of us, when we're in one place, we're thinking about the next place already.
Mm-hmm.
And what lies ahead,
yes.
And what I need to do,
yes.
And
yes.
What I have to pick up along the way,
mm-hmm.
And what I got to move around, because
mm-hmm.
Now I ain't got enough time to do everything that I had planned to do.
Mm-hmm.
Can I tell you, if we keep
yes.
Running that race that way, we will never have rest. God did everything in 6 days, and then created rest on the seventh. If God created rest, it wasn't for him, it was for us.
Yes.
Amen.
Can I tell you, in Jewish culture, mm. Even today, they look forward to the Sabbath because
yes.
It's a time of celebration. They celebrate stop working.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Which for many of us, you can't even fathom that.
Yeah.
But they celebrate it because it's a time to be with the Lord. It's a time to be with family. It's a time to unwind. It's a time to heal. Because all the clutter is removed for 24 hours. I'm just asking, what would it look like for you today if you decided that sometime this month that you were going to just take 2 hours
yes.
And not fill it with anything?
Yes.
No phone calls, no emails, no tweets, no Facebook posts. I'm going to pray, and then here's what we're going to do. We're going to take a couple minutes, because I know some of y'all, you got your task list in your phone. Others of you got it in your phone and memorized.
Yes.
So take a couple of minutes.
Mm-hmm.
And I want you to look at your calendar for the month. And I want you to tangibly put down at least 2 hours where you're going to rest.
Mm.
Because if you don't, and you keep going the pace you're going, you're going to burn out
yes.
And not be helpful to the kingdom or nobody else. Incidentally, you don't know this or not, but there are times when once everybody's out of my house during the week, I rest. I don't talk to y'all.
Hey,
I don't respond to y'all. I don't send no emails. I don't look at anything. I sit in silence, and I'm good.
Mm-hmm.
And you'll be amazed at what you can hear when you sit in silence.
Amen.
Mm-hmm. Let's pray. Father, we come to you because we need your guidance to rest. Some of us don't rest, don't sleep, don't stop. Keep going, trying to handle a world that you created that's in your hands, not ours.
Mm-hmm.
So God, help us to relinquish and let go. Help us to trust that whatever we put in your hands, you are more than capable to handle it. Remind us, God, that we're not God. You are. Remind us that we're not the Savior. Jesus is. Remind us we're not the God and the convictor. The Holy Spirit is. In essence, Lord, help us to stay in our lane and to trust you and to allow you to bring us rest. Then, God, when it doesn't make sense to us, let us still have childlike faith. When we don't have the answers, let us still trust and have childlike faith. When life just seems to keep rolling and we can't figure it all out, still help us to have childlike faith and know that whatever is supposed to be accomplished will be accomplished because it's all in your hands.
Amen.
And just like Jesus wrote, we will praise you continuously. Just being who you are. It's in Christ's name we pray. Let us all say together, Amen.
Amen.
Put your hands together, little baby. All right. I'm not playing. We got 2 minutes. If you got your calendar in your phone, get it out. 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 If you got a planner, get it out. If you keep it in your head, borrow somebody's paper, write it down.
Mm-hmm.
Month of May, 2 hours. What 2 hours are you going to give God? That adds a whole nother perspective on it, don't it? What 2 hours are you going to give him? If you're watching online, you got calendar, phone. If it's on the fridge, go grab it, wherever it is. 2 hours.
Mm-hmm.
2 hours. I don't think
think that's much to, to add. It's 2 hours. Some of y'all spend more than that shopping online.
Yes.
Ooh, ooh, stop it.
Yes, sir. 2 hours. Ooh, I just got something, y'all. I'm going to help you save some money. What's his name?
Yeah.
You're going to get to spend some time with Jesus and save some money all at the same time. Thank God, all right.
2 hours.
You got it?
Yep.
You got it?
Starting this week.
Amen. I know some of y'all, this is hard. I promise you the world won't fall apart.
Mm-hmm.
I promise you whoever it is or whatever it is going to be all right. And if for some reason it begins to fall apart, I promise you Jesus can handle it.
Amen.
All right. So you know you're going to see eventually some massively announcement, some kind of email, some kind of something on your phone asking, did you keep your 2 hours? A gentle nudge to say, this is all talking. Because it's easy for it to get crowded out.
Yeah.
All right. We're going to be ready to go, but before we do, we have our poem. Ladies, watch the screen. This is for you.
A woman's love. A woman's love is something that no one can explain. It is made of deep devotion, sacrifice, and pain. It is endless, unselfish, and enduring, come what may. For nothing can destroy it or take that love away. It never fails or falters when all others are forsaken. It is patient and forgiving, even when the heart is breaking. It believes beyond believing. When the world around condemns, and it glows with all the beauty of the rarest, brightest gems. It is far beyond defining. Defies all explanation, and it still remains a secret, like the mysteries of creation. A many-splendored miracle man cannot understand, and another wondrous evidence of God's tender guiding hand.
Amen.
Amen.
Can we put our hands together real good? Can we stay on our feet, my ladies? Ladies, we will certainly honor you for who you are. As you know, it's, as I mentioned before, we're trying to just do little pieces along the way to show you that God loves you and so do we. But honor and thank him for all of you. To those who were able to make it out to the Women's Corner yesterday, thank you so much. It was good to see your faces. I hope it was beneficial to you.
Oh, yes.
And we'll be doing it again, like, real soon. We've only got 2 announcements. Next week, bring somebody with you. We're going to honor you, ladies. The brothers have been planning things to just make you feel what you are, which is special in the sight of God and special to us. So we look forward to seeing you.
two other quick announcements. May 18th between 9:30 and 11:30, we're going to do community cleanup like we did last year. All the things that are needed to do that will just be here. Just bring yourself as a volunteer. And it's an easy way to invite somebody out who doesn't do church. You can say, this ain't about no church. This is about serving in the kingdom and getting out and just working together. You'll be amazed at what you can learn and how you can work together when you just come together and do something like that. And there will be lunch at the end of it. So tell them they get to serve, they get to hang out with some great people, meaning you, and they get to eat something. So that part is good. The other thing I want to put in your hand is on the first Monday of June, starting for the rest of the summer, I believe, 6 o'clock, gospel slide class. So those who are trying to work it out, counting the points and all of that. Now listen, I'm going to tell you, they're going to work you, but it's going to be the gospel music, but they're going to work you. So don't think because it's church you're going to come, if you're watching online, come. It ain't going to be some little cute, slow something. They're going to be in here moving. Trust me, I watched this. So come ready to sweat is what I'm telling you.
Don't be cute.
But it's a good thing.
Yes.
It's a good thing. So again, another way to plug in, an easy way to invite and bring somebody out to it. So every Monday starting at 6 right here, chairs will be up. It turns into your space and you go forward in the name of Jesus. All right?
All right.
All right. So we're going to be ready to go. Enjoy the rest of this beautiful Sunday. Here's what we're going to do. We're going to give and then just greet somebody.